And so as we begin today, that's exactly what we're going to be talking about. We'll be talking about how to neighbor. What does it look like to not just be around people, but to actually love people? And as our world grows more connected, our neighbors are closer than ever. You might not share a fence with them, but every single one of us can share burdens or can share the joys that people have in our life. And so we want to encounter that. So whenever you hear the word neighbor in this series, don't just think about who actually lives next door to your house, okay? We actually want you to consider all kinds of people. How to neighbor? That would include your family. How am I going to love my family? And this would include your friends, people that you encounter on a daily or weekly basis. This would include your online friends. So your online acquaintances, you may not have physically seen them in years, but you're still friends, at least on Facebook, at least as of this moment, until you decide not to be friends. And then we'll kind of go from there, right? So we want to talk about how to neighbor is also going to cover completely random strangers. We want to kind of just, whenever you hear the word neighbor, we want you to think about all kinds of people. And as we talk about this today, we need to acknowledge the reality of our world, okay? The reality of our world. And that is this. Today, it seems like we are more divided than ever. It seems like there is more tension, there's more division, there's more anti than ever, and the struggle is real. Is it just me, or are you feeling it too? Okay, all right, all across the room, a couple of us, raise my hand. Some of you, you're so tense, you can't even raise your hand. You're like, I'm just too tense, I can't even talk about it. So we understand that. So the chances are you're dealing with this tension, and we want to acknowledge it and also say a couple of things. First of all, you're not alone. Okay, if you're feeling that it's more divisive and you're frustrated by that and it hurts, quite honestly, your heart, sometimes the reality of our world, you're not alone. And secondly, you're not powerless. There's something that we can do. There's something that God's word is going to remind us to do. And so today, we want to navigate and deal and recognize this tension, but then also be a people who are willing to find hope or are willing to offer hope to those who are likewise feeling this tension as well. And so we simply say this, no matter who you are, however you voted, whomever you support, you are welcome here. Welcome to Oasis Church. We are so glad you are here. And so we want to be a people who kind of recognize that the world, all of us, we don't see eye to eye. And we want to go, okay, well, how do we be the church? How do we neighbor? How do we live the life that God is calling us to live, even though we don't see eye to eye with the people in our lives, the people in our family, the people that we're friends with, the people that we go to church with, the people that we work with, the people that we may live in the same neighborhood as? How do we neighbor? How do we deal with the tension? So we want to just simply say, if you don't hear anything else, here's our main point as we begin this series and as we begin today. So we're going to seek to find unity. So in our fight for unity with our neighbors, we must use the weapon of love. Okay? Just a couple of things I want to highlight. This is not a fight with our neighbors. Okay? So in our fight, okay, in our fight for what? For unity. We want to fight for peace. We want to fight for being on the same page. We want to fight as much as possible to be able to, at some level, to begin to see eye to eye so we can be unified. We want to fight for unity with our neighbors, with the people in our family, and our friends, and our coworkers, and our online friends. We want to fight for unity with our neighbors. And if we're going to do so, here's the weapon we're going to use. We're going to use the weapon of love. And so to set this up, a couple of things. First of all, we're going to kind of find out, okay, what did God say about this? And what did Jesus remind the people to do? In fact, Jesus was told and was asked a question. He said, you know, sum up the whole scripture. How do I know I'm right with God? How do I know I'm living correctly? How do I know I'm obeying the word? And Jesus replied to this question. He says this, that's a great question. Here's the answer. You must love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your mind. We covered this a little bit last week as we talked about choosing to live for the important over the urgent. Jesus says, you want to be right with me? It begins by this. You must love the Lord your God, all your heart, all your mind, all your soul. It's got to be the primary relationship in our life. The primary foundation of our life has got to be our extreme love for God. He says this in verse 38, this is the first and greatest commandment. A second is equally important. He says, love your neighbor as yourself. So Jesus says this, first and greatest commandment, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. Primary relationship. And the second is equally important. The idea here is when it comes to breathing, we inhale and we exhale. They are both part of breathing. The same thing is true what Jesus says. You love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. Inhale and you exhale. It's the same kind of love. You love your neighbor as yourself. They're not separate. They are together. And so Jesus is giving an understanding. Here's the main weapon. Here's the main weapon of love. And use this weapon to fight for unity, not only between God and us, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, but love your neighbor as yourself. We inhale and we exhale. And so we're going to say, okay, what does that look like for us? How does that live and what it look like in real life? How do I apply this today? Well, this is going to be some tense parts of the message, okay? So a couple things. I want to encourage you, be praying. Be praying that we hear from God, not from Jeremy today. Be praying that we hear from the Word of God, not from a person's opinion. And secondly, I'm praying for you, that you'll hear from God, and that you'll allow the Holy Spirit to, that we together will allow the Holy Spirit to speak to our hearts. So here's where it begins. When it comes to using the weapon of love to fight for unity, the first weapon, or the first way we use this weapon is simply this. We are to love Jesus above everything else. We are to love Jesus above everything else. You might say, okay, Jeremy, I got that. I just read the verse, right? That's what it says. I understand that. My pushback is, do we? Do we really understand what it looks like to have Jesus be the center, the most primary part of our worship? Because here's the reality. We talked about in our communion that all of us are sinners, that we all go our own way. And for many of us in this room, we've accepted Jesus Christ as our Savior. He's forgiven us of our sin, but the sin nature is still there. There's still a struggle between the old way of life and the new way of life. And so many of us, we tend to slip back to the old ways. We tend to slip back to giving things, other things that used to control our life. We give control back of our life to them instead of Jesus Christ. And as we do this, we kind of make these things our identity. We kind of make these things even our idol. And they become the center of our life. Things that we might think are not that big of a deal. When we say the word idol, we're like, okay, we know what that means. That's like a statue or something. But we say, no, it's much bigger than that. We can actually make our identity and our perspective an idol in our lives. And the question is, do we love Jesus above everything else? Okay, so here's where it gets a little tense. Because we look at our differences from others and we say, well, this is who I am. This is what I believe. And this makes me, this is how I see the world. And maybe we're not having Jesus be the center. For instance, we might say, I'm a Republican or conservative who is also a Christian. You might say, I'm a Democrat. I tend to vote and I lean toward the left and I follow Jesus. You might say, I'm a third party or a fourth party or 17th party, all right? And this is who I am, and I also happen to read the Bible, okay? We might say, well, you know what? I'm a white person, and I love Jesus. I'm an African-American, and I believe that Jesus is the way. Or I'm a Hispanic or an Asian person, but I also open the Bible and want to hear from God and follow Him. We might say, well, I'm a man, and I love Jesus. Or I'm a woman, and I'm ready to follow and just hear more from God today. All those things, they're all about order. When we say we're Republican and love Jesus, we're making one primary and one secondary. When we verbalize, I'm a Democrat and I'm willing to read the Bible and trust in Him, we're making one primary and one secondary. And you might say, well, that's just semantics. And I want to just push back, is it? What are we really allowing to control us? What are we really allowing to be the center of our lives? Because here's the reality. In 2 Corinthians 5, verses 14 and 15, it says this. Either way, Christ's love controls us. Since we believe that Christ died for all, we also believe that we all have all died to our old life. He died for everyone, so that those who receive his new life will no longer live for themselves. Instead, they will live for Christ, who died and was raised for them. So we're talking about the idea of following Christ and having Jesus' love be the most important thing, be above everything else. Are we controlled by Christ's love? The Bible says that we've died to that old way of thinking. We've died to that old way of living. And now we no longer live for ourselves. It's not about us. It's about Christ. And so we are to live for Jesus. So instead of what I said earlier, here's how this would look. I'm a follower of Jesus who happens to vote Republican. I'm a follower of Jesus who happens to vote Democrat. I'm a follower of Jesus and I believe in a third party. Or I'm a follower of Jesus. That has got to be center. So we don't read the Bible through Republican eyes or Democrat eyes. We read it through the eyes of Jesus. Christ has to control us. Christ has to be above everything. So I'm not a white person who follows Jesus. No, I'm a follower of Jesus. And God chose my skin color. I didn't choose that. So I'm a follower of Jesus who happens to be white. If you're African-American or Asian or Hispanic, okay, you're a follower of Jesus. If you are following Christ, if he is the center, if he is above everything else, you're a follower of Jesus first, who God has made your skin color. Now, again, I know this is so easy just to say, and there's so much background and perspective. And that's why I'm praying that we can talk about this. I'm praying that we can navigate this, because I believe it changes everything. It's not just semantics. So I'm not a man who follows Jesus. No, I'm a follower of Jesus who God has made me a man. I'm a follower of Jesus who God has made you a woman. And so we want to see again, what is going to call the shots? What's our main identity? And sometimes it gets tense for us, because no one likes when their idol is pointed out. No one likes, like, whoa, no, that's not comfortable. No. What if we actually lived Jesus above everything else? What if we actually verbalized this? What if we actually posted about this? What if we actually said, Jesus, I'm not controlling my hands as I do this status update. You are. So whatever you want me to post, I'll post. Jesus has got to be above everything else. It's not just semantics. I believe it changes everything when we allow Jesus to have the first and the final say of our life. Now, here's the reality of idols and identities. We can make a determination now, but that idol is going to creep back up tomorrow or next week. So to be a people who fight for unity with our neighbors, using the weapon of love, I believe the first and primary weapon is this: to love Jesus above everything else. So I hope you're still with me. I hope we're still there. I hope we can talk further with this, because I love you and I love Jesus. And I want Jesus to have the final say in our church and in our lives. Secondly is this, just in case you're wondering, yes, it's still going to be tense, just so you know, okay? All right? The second weapon of love is this. After we love Jesus first and primary above everything else, we are to love people more than we hate what is different. We're going to love people. We're going to love our neighbor more than we hate what is different about our neighbor. And here's the reality. Many of us, we see our world and we try to simplify our world, so we make it as simple as possible. So we put people in boxes. We put people in a different box. We put some people in the same box. Okay? Are you like me? You're in the same box. Are you different than me? You're in the different box. Do you like the same music I like? Same. Do you like a different kind of music? Different. Okay? Do you have lots of tattoos? Same. No tattoos. Tattoos you wish you didn't have. Okay, all right, what about those? All right, so we kind of do that, all right? So we can make everything, right, same and different. We can kind of just look at everything, and the reality is this. Do you vote like me? Do you vote opposite? Do you look like me? Do you not look like me? Do we have the same gender? Do we have? We couldn't kind of make anything this way, but statistically speaking, we are all different. We're all different. You break it down, you're not going to have anyone who is going to be completely like you in the same box. Is this the same box? Just making sure. Yeah, in the same box, okay? Just making sure, all right? It kind of loses its power if I'm the wrong one. So you're going to find someone where you're not going to be the same. Statistically, all of us are different. And as you put people in a different box, guess what box they're putting you in? Also in a different box. And so we're going to continue to have these divisions and tension. And the reality is, what if, crazy thought, what if we love people more than we hate what is different? What if we love you more than we dislike what is different about you, meaning that you're different than me? What if we love you more and most and primary? Why? Because Christ's love controls us. Because I'm no longer living for myself, so I'm living for Christ. And now I can love you more than I hate what is different. We love to put people in boxes. And as we put people in boxes, it's easy for us to look down on people. Okay? And here's the reality. In Proverbs 11:12, it says this: it is foolish to belittle one's neighbor. A sensible person keeps quiet. You may need to print that out and put that on your monitor. Just saying, all right? All right? It's foolish to belittle one's neighbor. Okay, this is not loving. That's not a loving way to treat people. And it says sometimes it's loving or maybe sensible just to not say anything. And just to pause and to say, God, okay, what do you want me to say? God, should I say anything? God, do I need to? God, I'm just going to close the laptop. I'm just going to close it up. And I'm going to put it away. I'm going to move on, right? We want to be a people who love others more than we hate what is different. So how does this look? How do we begin to do this? How do we begin to move forward? How do we neighbor? How do we reconcile the differences that are in our lives? Glad you asked, okay? First one is this. We want to recognize any prejudices that we have. Recognize any prejudices, okay? A prejudice is simply this, to have a preconceived opinion that is not based on reason or actual experience. To prejudge someone means, I don't know exactly you, but I've known people like you, and they were like this, so I guess you're like that too, before we even do anything, okay? A prejudice is simply a broad brush that we paint everyone with the same prejudgment. Some familiar ones like this, I just want to share, okay? This is perhaps some, maybe you relate to this or not, but all rich people are snobs, okay? That's a prejudice, okay? That's a prejudice that can't be true, but we just prejudge people that way. Another one would be this younger generation doesn't work. These millennials, they just don't work at all, okay? And that's a prejudging. That's a prejudice, okay? It's a broad brush. Mega pastors are crooks, okay? All mega pastors are crooks. No, that's a prejudging. That's a prejudice. Old people can't teach. Okay, it's time for, they're done, it's time to move on. No, that's prejudice. White guys can't jump, okay? That might actually be true, I don't know, that might actually be true, right? So the reality is this, all right? We all have prejudices. We all tend to prejudge, and that's why we have boxes. We prejudge you, so I put you in the different box. Well, you're probably like this, and you voted that way, so you're gonna be like this, and it's just a broad brush. And so the way we neighbors begin to recognize, do I have any prejudices? And after thinking about that for one millisecond, you go, okay, I do. So what are they? And begin to call them out. Begin to name them. Begin to recognize that that's reality in our life. Because again, I don't want to go through life with a prejudice. I want to fight for unity with my neighbors using the weapons of love. So therefore, I want to love you more than I hate what is different. So when we recognize that we're prejudging someone, we need to now move on to the next thing. We need to seek to understand. The reason we prejudice our prejudges, we don't really know their situation. So secondly, we want to seek to understand. We want to know, okay, well, why do you believe this? Or why do you vote that way? Or what in your past causes you to see the world this way? We want to begin to know them. And to love someone means you can't love from a distance. You gotta know their story. To love someone means you're gonna neighbor that person. You're going to, the same way you want someone to hear your story, you wanna hear someone else's story. Love your neighbor as yourself. So we begin to understand, listen, I wanna show you that I love you more than I hate what is different. And I wanna know what's in your past, what's your story, what is God doing, what has God brought you through? I want to know you. Why? Because I love you more than I hate what is different. And as we recognize and see the differences, what if, number three, we begin to celebrate the differences? You see, we've been taught, if you're different, you're not like me, so you must be bad and I must be good. And so I'm against you because you're different. No. Let's turn that around. What if we celebrate the differences? You voted that way? Awesome. I love it. We don't need everyone to vote the same way. Trust me, we'd be messed up, okay? You vote differently? Awesome. You believe this differently? Oh, that's great. And we need that. Yeah. This works even in a relationship of two. Husband and wife, you're not like me. I know, opposites attract, okay? Celebrate the differences. Celebrate what God has brought together. God's got a great sense of humor, okay? He's laughing, all right? Celebrate that. All right, so I'm so glad you're different than me. You might have to utter that underneath your breath a couple times. I'm glad you're different than me. I'm glad you're different than me. Celebrate the differences, all right? And friends and family. There's even now, like, people come together for family holidays and they don't talk. They don't get along because of the difference. No. Celebrate the differences. Begin to say, how do we begin to engage in the tension? And how do I begin to show love for you more than I hate what is different? Because the reality is this. There's always more. There's always more to people than what we first choose to see. So let's get beyond prejudging. Let's celebrate the difference. And let's remember again that God's the one who's a creative God. God's the one who made us all different. God is the one who even our skin color, he can make us all look the same. No. We have a creative God. He loves to paint. Have you seen the sunset and the sunrise? We have an amazing God. And so here's the reality. God loves Asian Americans. God loves African Americans. God loves Latin Americans and Native Americans and Caucasian Americans. And guess what? God loves people who aren't Americans. Right? Just so we know, okay? He celebrate the differences. That means that God loves Cubans and God loves Hondurans. God loves Nigerians and Haitians and Jamaicans. God loves Koreans and Chinese. God loves the Iranians. God loves Syrians. God loves Russians. God loves all kinds of beautiful people. And so because we have a creative God who made us different, let's celebrate the differences. What if as a church, this is what became known? You're different? Awesome. Welcome. We're glad you're here. You make us better. Why? Because you're different. And we need your perspective and we need your thoughts and we need the way that you love and follow Christ and what he's brought you through. Why? Because we're part of the family. We're the family of God. So we want to be a people. How to neighbor? We're going to love people more than we hate what is different. And in Revelation, we get a picture of what heaven looks like. And it's people of all different tongues, all different nations, all different backgrounds, all different skin colors, all coming together to worship Christ, Jesus, above everything else. If that's our eternity, let's start now. Let's start now. Celebrate the differences. I'm going to love you more than I hate what is different. And then thirdly is this. As we seek to use these weapons of love, we love Jesus above everything else. We love people more than we hate what is different about other people. And then thirdly, we love people more than we love being right. We love people more than we love being right. And how's the reality is this. These same boxes we put people in. You think like me? Well, I think that way too. So clearly we're both right. You don't think like me? You are wrong. And we put people in boxes, don't we? And we label and we write off people. No, we agree totally. All right, you're right. Because I'm right, right? And if you're wrong, then that means you're wrong. But here's the reality. Every single one of us, we put ourselves in the right box, right? 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 I told you, see, I was right. Look, I told you, right? We all put ourselves here in the right box because we think we're right. And everyone else, oh, they're wrong. Oh, that person, no, they're wrong. And they think that they're right and we're wrong. So here's the reality. I don't know about you, but I love being right. I love being right. But to neighbor someone means I'm going to love you more than I love being right. I'm going to love you because God loves you and God loves me. And since he's the center of my life, he's commanded me to love you more than I love being right. And as we realize that, we realize boxes are stupid. It's not the way to live. That's not our reality. God says, no, love people more than you love being right. Because here's the reality. Right and wrong force us to prejudge people. We're going back to that. They force us to elevate ourselves and lower other people. They force us to live a life of pride. They force us to once again bow down at the altar of me. And I make a horrible God. And so do you. Because that's not our role. And so Jesus says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. And if we love people more than we love being right, then we find ourselves humbling ourselves. And the Bible says this in Psalm 101, verse 5, we see King David saying a prayer that echoes what God has said and revealed himself about himself to us. He says this, I will not tolerate people who slander their neighbors. I will not endure conceit and pride. Pride goes before a fall. We all think we're in the right box. We're setting ourselves up for a fall. That's pride. And God says, I hate pride. I look for those who are humble in heart, humble in action, humble in thought. And so in our pride, we cut down other people. We slander them. And God says, I will not tolerate that. Instead, Jesus tells us how to live in Matthew 5, verse 9. And he says this, God blesses those who work for peace, for they will be called the children of God. If you grew up with memorizing the KJV, blessed are the peacemakers. This is what we're saying. Fight for unity with our neighbors. Fight for peace with our neighbors. Use the weapons of love. I love how we, and sometimes when you prepare a message, you see different things throughout the week. So I saw a post pop up on my Facebook feed from Pastor Darrow of the Journey Church up in Nassau County. He says this, as Christians, we're called to be peacemakers. And he writes, how are you doing? If you're not sure, maybe read your last 10 posts. Then he says, have a great day. Right? That's our reality. I love people more than I love being right. Fight for peace with our neighbors. Fight for unity with our neighbors. Now again, we've shared, take about 30 minutes to share this. Done, right? Accomplished. No. It's going to take work. It takes work to love someone in this way. It takes work to love Christ in this way. But the reality is this, God must have confidence in his completed work on the cross because he brought us all together. And we are one. We are united as one because of Christ. And so listen, no matter how you vote, no matter your background, no matter whether you march or don't march, we're to fight for unity. We're to fight for unity with our neighbors. So what does that mean? Well, I'm going to love the person who posts differently than I do. I'm going to love the person who posts about puppies instead of politics. Because don't they know social media is all about politics and not puppies, all right? I'm going to love the person on the other side of the political aisle. I'm going to love the person who doesn't have the same skin color as me. I'm going to be kind to the person who chooses to be silent. I'm going to be kind of the person who never shuts up. I'm going to love all people. Why? Because Christ loves us. Christ's love controls us. We no longer live for ourselves. We live for Christ, Jesus, love above all else. And because of that, I'm going to love my neighbor as myself. I'm going to love you more than I hate what is different between us. I'm going to love you more than I hate more than I love being right. In 2 Corinthians 5:18, we're reminded it's not just for this world, this is for eternity. It says this, and all of this is a gift from God who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. Why is love so important? Well, it matters for this world but it also matters for eternity. The Bible says that they will know you are Christians by your love. So, if we're loving being right more than loving people, that's not going to reconcile anyone to God. That's not good news. If we're going to hate what is different more than loving people who are different, that's not going to allow someone to be convicted of their sins and seek after God. But when we love God the way that God loves us, when we love other people the way that God loves us, that changes everything. So people can look at us and go, why are you different? We say, here's why. Jesus. We were separated and he brought us connected with God. He changed my heart. He can change yours. But why are you willing to engage people who are different than you? What? Jesus. We were different. We were rebels in our sin and God came after us and bridged the divide. He reconciled us. He brought us in connection with him. Because he did that, I want to do that with you. But more importantly, I want you to find connection with God as well. You see, we believe that God has given us this message of reconciliation. This is the Great Commission. So eternity is at stake in how we neighbor. So how do we reconcile the differences? We fight. We fight for peace. We fight for unity. And our weapons are love. Love of Christ, love of others. Let's go ahead and close in a word of prayer. I know we covered a lot today. And now's where it gets real for each of us individually. God, as we close this time, speak to our hearts. Point out what needs to be addressed and dealt with, as only you can do. God, help us to surrender those areas of our heart to you. Maybe you're here today and the part where God was speaking to you was loving people more than you love being right. Would you just confess that to God? Give that to God even now. Ask God to humble you. Ask God to help you love people more than you love being right. Maybe it's the area of differences and we love to prejudge and God is saying that's you. You put people in boxes. Would you just want to pray right now? God, I don't want that to be my life. Help me to love people more than I hate what's different. God, help me to throw away the boxes. And see people the way you see them. Whatever God's saying to you, press into that. Don't pull away. Press into this moment and give that to God and seek his help and his will and his way in these areas. Maybe it was that whole first part about idols. And we've made things that should not be the center of our lives, the center of our lives. And as I say we, I mean, yes, you and me. We all do this. So as God points this out, confess that. Realign your life with Christ at the center, if you're already following Jesus. Maybe you walked in today and you're not a follower of Jesus, and today you're ready to come home. You're ready to be made new. You're ready to be connected with God. The way that happens, you've heard over and over, is Jesus. Jesus' love for you changes everything. Jesus died on the cross for your sin, for your rebellion, and he offers you a way to come home, and that way is him. We believe that he died for our sins, that he was buried, and that he rose again. He offers you life. We have a living Lord. If you've never given your life to him, today is your moment. Here's how you do that. Jesus, today, I believe. I believe I'm a sinner. I believe I've gone against you. But I believe that you also have made a way for me to be forgiven. So Jesus, today I receive you as my Savior. I believe you died for me. I believe that you love me. So from this moment forward, I follow you. You're my Lord. My life is controlled by you. I no longer live for me. I live for you. It's all about you. If that is your prayer, that is how you receive salvation all across this room. Whatever God is saying to us, let's say yes and follow him as his people. God, we love you and you love us more than we could ever ask or imagine. Help us to live in light of your great love this week, not only for ourselves, but to those around us. In your name we pray. Amen and amen.